Three, two, one. Here we are at the back of the top 10. That means we must bring on Jeff Kavanaugh, someone who's very close. This Cowboys team does excellent work on the draft. Jeff, Cowboys offense started out wonderfully last year. Dak Prescott, CeeDee Lamb, Amari Cooper, Michael Gallup. So much fun. Then it obviously took a dive as soon as Dak went down injured. So here at pick 10 in a draft that I think is very top heavy, where do you think are the positions of need that they could target at the selection?
Oh, I think the Cowboys are, first of all, I'd like to commend them and chastise them at the same time for they are not very leaky this year. I know a lot of people and I generally can find things, but now I'm just using common sense. But my common sense is saying that even though the offense wasn't good last year, it was because your offensive line was hurt and your quarterback was hurt. Your defense was bad last year because you didn't have good football players and you had an awful coach and you had an awful plan the whole time, offseason included. So I think it makes all the sense in the world that the Cowboys are staring at number 10, fully anticipating that they're going to be picking Patrick Surtain. And if that's not available, perhaps that they are going to be picking J.C. Horn. That would be my initial thought. My secondary thought is, let's see what happens in the first nine. Because if we draw up a world where, let's say, Surtain goes nine or somewhere, or even that he doesn't, but what happens to Kyle Pitts? What happens to Penei Sewell? What happens to Rashawn Slater? I think are things they would have to consider if you get to 10 and any of those are available.
Do you think that edge rusher would be probably too early? It doesn't seem like there's an edge rusher that's willing to or that should be drafted that high. To me, it seems like Surtain is the lights out pick. If not him, I think J.C. Horn would be an awesome pick. I could actually see Jerry Jones falling for J.C. Horn and his like really rare athleticism. Obviously, Surtain's a great athlete too. Do you think that it's just corner if it's going to be defense?
I think, see, I drop these scenarios in my head where I try to think like Jerry, and when I try to think. When I try to think like Jerry, I end up talking like Jerry, and so then I end up in this place where I go like,
"That Micah Parsons now, that Micah Parsons, he sure does fly around. I think we could sell a lot of Parsons jerseys, and we could, and did, and will, and we will, and did." And then, like,
are you on a yacht while you're doing this?
Yes, yes.
And I'm on. I just called a boat. It's my dinghy.
I'm a little floaty here in the pool.
Yep, yep. Now, so like it kind of made me raise an eyebrow when Daniel Jeremiah did a mock and he gave him Quiddy Pay. And I was just like, don't do this to me. Don't tell me that Jeremiah's got somebody and that there's interest there. I really struggle thinking that any of these edge guys are worthy of the 10th pick. And even if they were, mine's not Quiddy Pay. So, they love drafting defensive ends and they love drafting corners. It's two things that they love to do. But this particular year, I think that corner is easily the bigger need. And so it lines up better. And I don't think there's an edge that belongs in the conversation. There's not a D tackle that belongs in the conversation. I don't think there's a linebacker that belongs in the conversation. But again, I could see Jerry thinking differently. And I think that's why I'm so zeroed in on corner at 10. And if not, then the wild card would be the Tyron Smith and Lyle Collins health. And to me, it's a little bit unique this year because I think that Penei Sewell or Rashawn Slater could easily, if Tyron Smith is healthy, just step in and be a kick-ass left guard.
Yeah.
So it's like it fits. And Elijah Vera Tucker, too. I'm just going to throw his name out there because I'm a big fan of his tape. And I think he belongs in the top 10 or 15 conversation.
So as someone who's just listening and trying to piece this together, most likely it's four names. It's Surtain, it's Horn, it's Sewell, or Slater. So, Pitts. Well, yeah, but I mean, I just think Pitts is almost certainly gone at four or five or six. Like, and if he goes past there, that might be the shock, the surprise of the draft. I know you're hoping to wish it into existence here, Jeff, but
it worked last year with CeeDee. I just got to do it one more time.
True. Again, we're on with Jeff Kavanaugh, 105.3 The Fan. You can also check out his Twitch channel, twitch.tv/Jeff Kavanaugh. All right. So it's not like Dallas ends their draft at number 10. They have pick 44. They have picks 75, 99, 115, 138. We just discussed how, you know, the offensive line in a year or two could go from one of the best groups on paper to looking quite old and deteriorating quite quickly. Kind of saw that with Kansas City's offensive line last year after just winning the Super Bowl. But I'm sure there's plenty of other positions. We've talked about defense quite a bit, but maybe the biggest jump is going from what? Mike Nolan to Dan Quinn. Have you looked into at all what Dan Quinn found as his critical factors back in Atlanta and maybe tried to connect those pieces here with defensive players in this draft?
Well, what I worry about with that is last year the Cowboys decided that what they wanted to do is sign all the defensive tackles from Carolina after Carolina had a really bad run defense. So you signed all their D tackles and one got hurt and the other one couldn't play. And so Dan Quinn, I think we all have a picture in our mind of a guy that's running sort of a cover three defense where the corners are bailing and you've got a deep free safety. And so like part of my brain is thinking about, okay, where are the true free safeties in this draft? And is that a way that we should go? And then the other part of my brain is like, but the NFL changes and there's so much RPO. And if you run cover three, you get shredded by it. Is Dan Quinn smart enough to realize that? So it's tough because I just have parts of my brain battling, but I do drift towards thinking about cover three, about corners that are long, corners that can run, corners that can play a ball in the air, safeties that can play 15 yards back there and get sideline to sideline. And yeah, that affects, I think, some of the names that I talk about with the Cowboys. I haven't heard them linked to Richie Grant, Central Florida free safety, but I think he's a great fit. I think he's a guy that at 44, if he's there, I love it.
Yeah.
And some of the names that they are being linked to, I don't think are as good a fits. Trevon Merrig. And I don't think that he's a real life deep center field free safety. And yet it's like, oh yeah, they worked out Merrig and Washington. Ardarius Washington, by the way, is my pizza party guy this year. If the Cowboys pick him, I'll throw a pizza party. He's the better.
Are we invited?
He's the better TCU. Yes. He's the better TCU safety. Just the world hates 5'7¾ guys. It's unfortunate, truly. So yeah, I mean, they have a lot of needs.
Yeah.
They need a corner. They need a free safety. The sneaky need is linebacker. Because
talk about linebacker, because like this is a position where they've just invested so heavily in over the last 5 years. But here we are again, even suggesting that an outside chance it might be like their fifth option at pick number 10.
Well, yeah, because I think with Leighton Vander Esch, he's struggled to stay on the field. And so you have a first-round pick that here in a couple of weeks, you've got to decide if you're going to give him $10 million for his fifth season or if you're not. And if I'm the Cowboys, I mean, that needs to be a real discussion. I don't think that's a definitive, heck yeah, let's go. And also, if I'm the Cowboys, I'm looking at Jalen Smith's contract, and I'm like, all right, so we're not getting rid of him this year. But after this year, I'd rather save that money unless he's going to show us a return to like 2018 form. So I think there's a decent chance that 12 months from today, the Cowboys would like to have two new linebackers. And so you've got other more pressing needs probably in this moment. But as you're looking into the very near future, there's the possibility that you need a lot of linebacker help. And I hope they don't at 10, but at 44 or 75 or 99, I think it's a real possibility.
Well, this is a fantasy football podcast partly, so I need to ask you about Ezekiel Elliott because I think he's getting drafted a little bit later than where I'm going to be ranking him just because last year with Dak Prescott, he was really balling out. He was like a top five fantasy running back. He's not being drafted there this year. I think some people are scared about the injury late last year. Zeke didn't look fully right to me just looking at him, and then Tony Pollard started mixing in a little bit. Do you think that it's going to be the classic Zeke workload, or do you think Pollard might mix in a little bit more than usual?
I think it'll be close to the classic Zeke workload. I think they like Pollard, and he brings something completely opposite of what Zeke brings, whereas Zeke will never get tackled for a loss, and if it's third and one or third and goal, he'll likely get your yard. He ain't going to get you 30, and Tony Pollard will do that sometimes. He can actually avoid tackles and make you some big plays. But I think that the Cowboys are a little bit unique in this way. But like Jalen Smith, Ezekiel Elliott, these are Jerry guys. Mm-hmm. He's got T-shirts with Feed Me. You get, like he's a big part of the Cowboys brand. And Ezekiel Elliott's going to get the ball. He's going to get the ball a lot. Zeke's going to get the ball more than I want him to. Okay. That's going to happen. He'll be safe on your fantasy teams. Just go ahead and pick him.
Jeff Cavanaugh, thanks so much for joining us. Appreciate you, buddy.
I love you.
I love you too.